Luis Caffarelli, who will give a mini course this Thursday and next Thursday on the issues in homogenization for problems for non-divergent problems.
Okay,
thank you very much.
So today's
talk went from 2 to 3, and then a 30-minute break for tea, and 3:30 to 4:30.
Okay, so I thought I will start to sort of talk a little bit about the difference between equation in divergence and non-divergence form. You know, although we usually lump both together, right? They are sort of from the philosophical and technical point of view very different. Okay, so we have you see elliptic equations divergence of aij, that is di, of aij, dj of u equal to 0 or equal to f, right? And the non-divergence, this appears in calculus of variations, in problems of continuum mechanics, and the non-divergence equation, aij of x, dij of u equal to 0 or f. Okay? So the equations in divergence form appear usually as I said, in continuum mechanics, in calculus of variations. I would be interested in problems where the aijs are not too nice, because they may be discontinuous, or are not too nice because they are very nice but very oscillatory. And therefore, if you want to sort of use results for an equation like that, then you cannot make any assumption on the modulus of continuity of the coefficients. Okay, so in some sense you need to use the rough theory. Okay, now so equations in divergence form, as I said, appear like that. They come from calculus of variations, right? Then they have the structure di of f I of gradient u equal to 0, right? This is a vector field. In general, the most common case is when this vector field is the gradient of a convex function. That is in calculus of variations, where you minimize the integral of some function f of gradient u, okay? And then the Euler-Lagrange equation is this one, where this is this vector field fi is the gradient of f. Okay, the operator being elliptic, we'll discuss a little bit more later why elliptic is elliptic. It requires aij to be a positive matrix, a uniform elliptic, a strictly positive matrix in both cases. This is equivalent here to us that f be strictly convex. Okay, you can see that if f is not strictly convex, then the problem you have when you try to find a minimizer is that sort of a wiggle may have less energy than a line, okay? And therefore, you have problems when you look or try to compute the energy of the limit, you have troubles. I mean, there is a big theory of relaxation and so on, okay? So convexity guarantees, in some sense, that planes are minimizers. Divergence equations are basically integral equations. Although they look like derivatives, they are integrals. Because if you look at any way you prove any theorem when you don't have regularity of the coefficients, it's usually by multiplying and integrating by parts. You know, solution lives in Hilbert spaces. They are in H1, in H2, H something. And you cannot show me a single solution. For aij Hilbert continuous, you cannot show me a single solution or super solutions, right? If I ask you, is x squared, right, has to be a sub-solution for any right x squared, you cannot compute that. And unless aij is at least Lipschitz and you can pass the derivative through, you cannot see solutions, okay? So all the theory is based in energy considerations and things like that, okay? Let's see what else. If you look at 1D, always it's very good to look at 1D whenever you start looking at a problem. If you look at 1D, solutions of these equations are basically dx of a of x dx of u equal to f, or let's say to 0 even. Okay, so a of x dx of u equal to a constant, right? That says that the first derivatives of the solution are like the coefficients. Okay, you cannot expect better than that. So whenever you try to do a priori estimates for equations in divergence forms, you are always missing a derivative. Okay, you are always short a derivative of what you expect. Okay. So they are very nice and very natural to start with because of the energy considerations. They are not so good to do higher regularity and so on. there was something else I wanted to say. Okay. The other thing is an important fact in studying an elliptic equation is the way, how do you pass from the infinitesimal to the local? In other words, how can you say from this apparent infinitesimal equation some statement like regularity, Harnack inequality, control of the oscillation, and so on? And in that sense, divergence equations are much easier than non-divergence equations because they are integral equations in some sense. So for instance, the proof of the Harnack inequality for divergence equations happened many years before the proof of the Harnack inequality for non-divergence equations, because it was much easier to relate the equation to sort of non-infinitesimal considerations. Non-divergence equations non-divergence equations, the sort of the linear versions are dij of u, let's say equal to 0 or to f. The non-linear versions are f of d square of u equal to 0. So for instance, a typical example of f of d square of u is equal to 0 is are the extremal operators. See, when you do optimal control, so let me give you an example. Okay, how do you get a fully nonlinear equation? A fully nonlinear equation, a typical example is the following. I have a domain, right, and I start a random walk. And when I hit the boundary, I'm going to be paid phi of x. Okay. And you want to compute what is the sort of the average amount you will get if you start at the point x0. It's the expected average, the expected earnings if you do this many times. Okay, so if the random walk is like a perfectly symmetric, you get the Laplacian. Okay, so if you have a random walk and the random walk you just you start here and you shoot with equal probability in a little ball and repeat, and equal probability in a little ball and repeat, then u satisfies the Laplace equation when the little ball radius of the little ball goes to 0. If you are shooting an ellipsoid, then or you satisfy in a non-perfectly symmetric way, then the random walk satisfies a non-divergence equation but with different coefficients. Okay, so. So depending on what is your information of how you are walking in the domain, right, then you get a different equation, aij of x, dij of u equal to 0. Suppose you don't know anything, you don't know exactly how your random walk is, but you have some rough information. So suppose, for instance, that the matrix Aij is between the identity and 2 times the identity. Okay, so you know sort of that your work is not terribly eccentric. Okay, and then you ask what is the best case scenario or what is the worst case scenario, or can I design my work as to maximize earnings? Okay, so in other words, the guy can choose for every point a matrix Aij of x, right? And I can choose for every point a matrix Aij of x and try to optimize that way. Okay. So I said that in order to solve that problem, and really what you have to do is you have to solve the following fully nonlinear problem. In other words, you have to find, so you solve that problem by doing the following. You have to find a function u0, right, that satisfies that when you look at the d square of u0, look at the d square of u0 has to have two eigenvalues, 1 lambda 2 in some system of coordinates. Okay. And then what you have to, u0 must solve that 2 times lambda plus lambda minus is equal to 0. Okay. So this is a fully nonlinear. It's an f of d square, which is rather nonlinear, right? You have to take the d square of u, you have to compute the eigenvalues, right? You have to multiply the largest by 2, the smaller by 1, and the sum has to be 0. Okay. So why is this the solution of that problem? Well, the first observation is, okay, the matrix Aij being between the identity and 2 times the identity, right, is invariant under rotations. So I can rewrite this equation in any system of coordinates I want at every point and will be of this form. Okay? So I say that if I find such a function u0, this function u0 is a super solution for any of these equations. Okay? Because if you give me an equation like this, right, and I try to test it in u0, I can take the system of coordinates of the eigenvectors. Okay? That will rotate the matrix Aij. I will have to multiply right and left by the affine transformation, but still will be between the identity and 2 times the identity. Okay? So I will have an equation which will be alpha. That equation in this system will be of the form alpha lambda plus beta lambda minus, right, where alpha is less than 2, is between 1 and 2, and beta is between 1 and 2. So this is going to be negative because I'm decreasing the coefficient of the positive eigenvalue and increasing the coefficient of the negative 1. So that means this solution is a super solution of any of these equations. And for every point, right, a posteriori, I can find the matrix Aij that makes it a solution. Okay? So this function u, in some sense, satisfies that the supremum of Aij of x, dij of u0, is identically 0. So the typical fully nonlinear is the supremum of a family of linear equations, or the inf of the sup. Okay, the supremum, they are called the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equations. The inf of the sup are called the Isaacs equations. Okay? So the solutions, the equations in non-divergence form, basically live in spaces of continuous functions, you know, continuous, Hilbert continuous, C1 alpha, C2 alpha, and so on. Okay? And if you want to make a sense of an equation like this when the coefficients are rough enough, right, then there is an idea which is called the concept of viscosity solutions. Okay, so let me try to explain a little bit what is a viscosity solution of a linear or fully nonlinear equation in non-divergence form. And then the concept of viscosity, so there is the concept of, so, okay, so let me say first the two or three things about non-divergence equations. So non-divergence equations, you don't have energy. Instead, what you have are solutions, super solutions. You can write explicit, in general, solutions and super solutions. You can have many barriers. So what you have is barriers. What you have is comparison principle. In other words, two solutions of the same equation cannot touch at a point in general. So let me make a little list of the tools you have for. So for fully nonlinear, for non-divergence equations, the theory is usually based on comparison principle. And therefore, on the Perron method, and the fact that solutions, in some sense, are order, monotonicity or order, ordering, and the fact that you have good barriers. In other words, you can many times write explicit super and super subsolutions. Okay, so let me try to explain you in a simple way how does the theory of viscosity solutions work. Okay, so let's start in 1D, right? And the idea is by using comparison with nice functions to decide if a continuous function is a solution or a super solution of a PDE. Okay, so in 1D, I want to define UXX, let's say, smaller or equal than 0 for a continuous function, okay? For U continuous. And I say, okay, I'm going to say that UXX is the continuous function U satisfies UXX smaller or equal than 0 if the only way I can touch it at a point by below with the parabola is that the parabola itself is concave. In other words, satisfies UXX smaller or equal than 0. Okay? So for U continuous, I would say UXX is smaller or equal than 0 if the only way a parabola that is a second order polynomial touches U from below is that PXX is forced to be smaller or equal than 0. Notice that I'm not asking that the function U be nice that has to be touched at every point or at many points by a parabola. In principle, you know, could be something extremely wiggly that is touched only in a countable number of points by a parabola, right? I mean, I'm not asking anything of that. All I'm asking is that if you manage to touch it by a parabola by below, then you have no choice. The parabola has to satisfy UXX. So in 1D, it's easy to prove that then UXX has to be a line. Theorem, U is a line. So you have to take 2 points, right? And if U goes, let's say, above the graph of the line somewhere, you take this. No, I see. Okay, UXX equal to 0. Theorem UXX equal to 0. That is, if this and the opposite hold, right? UXX equal to 0 is a line. Because if the graph happens to go, let's say, below the line somewhere, then I can draw this very flat parabola who is convex and touches the graph. So, and if the And if the graph goes above, then I do the opposite parabola. In other words, if U is a super and a subsolution, then it has to be a line. Okay? This doesn't seem that can go too far, right? So let me go a little bit farther and I say, okay, a continuous function is harmonic if the only way I can touch it by above is by a quadratic polynomial, is that the quadratic polynomial be subharmonic. And touch it by below is that the quadratic polynomial be superharmonic. Okay? So theorem, a harmonic function is indeed a classical harmonic function. So I have the continuous function, right? And I can take a little circle. I know how to solve harmonic functions in little circles, right? Because it's a Poisson kernel. So I know how to explicitly solve a harmonic function with prescribed continuous boundary data in a little circle. So I take any little circle, right? And I solve the harmonic function. So let me make a bigger picture of that. I have my big parent function. I take a little circle and I solve the corresponding harmonic function. And everything is continuous, right? And if the harmonic function does not coincide, if the classical harmonic function does not coincide with my function in this circle, I can lift this up or down until it touches it from above or from below. So I can lift it a lot up and then bring it down, and it's going to touch over here. But the classical harmonic function, right, is smooth, so it starts like a quadratic polynomial. So there I have a quadratic polynomial that touches it by above, right? And that is a contradiction. I mean, it's harmonic, I can bend it a little bit and get a contradiction, okay? So what is important about this, so I want to say two things important about this. The important thing about this, the first important thing about this is that this automatically tells you what ellipticity should be. Ellipticity, what happens at the contact point? What happens at the contact point is that the Hessian of the function above is bigger than the Hessian of the function below. Okay? And so an equation is elliptic, a second order equation will be elliptic, if it's monotone as a function of the Hessian, right? That's what happens with the Laplacian. That is, if your Laplacian is a positive matrix or a linear equation, right? In a linear equation is A dot n, right? Where A is a positive matrix. And so this is a monotone function of m. If I add to m positive function, right? If I have a positive matrix, then the function grows. Okay? The other thing that I want to say is that one way one should look at a linear or nonlinear equation, right, in divergence form, this form, is like a surface in the space of matrices. I want to look at the Laplacian, right? The Laplacian is a surface. In fact, it's a hyperplane of the space of matrix, right? If the space is a set of matrices whose trace is zero, okay? So I want to look at the Laplacian. As the equation Laplacian of u equal to zero, right, as the Hessian d square of u, which is a symmetric matrix M, lying in the space of matrix of trace zero. in the hyperplane. And in some sense, this in some sense, I want also to think that to define the Laplacian, right, therefore, all I have to do is I'll give you a long list of which polynomials, which quadratic polynomials are subsolutions of the equation and which quadratic polynomials are super solutions of the equation. Okay? In other words, I want to say, you know, Laplacian is like a hyperplane in the space of matrices, right? And so to define this hyperplane, to define this surface, all I have to do is I have to tell you what is above and what is below, right? So all the matrices which are above. Now, a matrix is like a polynomial because it's the Hessian of a polynomial, right? So to define the Laplacian, right, you know, suppose we don't know what the Laplacian is, all I have to do is to give you an enormous list and tell you, okay, 2x squared minus y squared is above. 3x squared minus y squared is above. X squared minus 2y squared is below, and so on. If I can sort of classify for every polynomial, I can find a way to tell you if it's a super or subsolution, I am defining the surface. Okay. The other thing that, so for instance, Monge-Ampere equation, right? So, okay, so Monge-Ampere equation. Is the determinant of d square of u, let's say, let's do the determinant of the square of u equal 1. Okay? So I want to think of it as being sort of as saying that the Hessian d square of u, right, lives in this surface. This is a surface in the space of matrices. Okay? And what does it make the operator elliptic? The operator elliptic, we said that for the operator to be elliptic, right, it has to be monotone in the space of matrices, right? In other words, the operator is elliptic. You take any line, so you take any matrix M0, right, and you add T times a positive matrix, right, and the line has to cross the surface. In other words, the operator is elliptic if it is a graph in the direction of any positive matrix. Okay? And it's uniformly elliptic if it is still a graph in the direction of a matrix whose positive part is bigger than a multiple of the negative part. In other words, if sort of it is a Lipschitz cone, it's a Lipschitz graph in the directions of positive matrix. You can tolerate a negative piece as long as it is small enough. Okay, so elliptic means monotonicity and uniform ellipticity. This means that the surface that defines the operator, defines the equation, is a graph in the direction of any matrix of the form m minus n, both positives, provided that n is smaller or equal than little lambda over capital lambda. This is these are the ellipticity constants, right? Norm of m. So for instance, if you look at the Monge-Ampere equation, that if you look at the level surface, the determinant of m equal to 1, there are many pieces. Right? In particular, there is a piece that so if you look at the determinant of m equal to 1, right, there are different disconnected pieces. There are two important ones. One is when the matrix is, let's say we are in R4, So the matrix are positive and the matrix are negative. Okay. So those two pieces, right, are surfaces that define elliptic equations. You have to choose one of them. Okay, the other piece, there are other pieces, like you could have two positive and two negative eigenvalues. Those surfaces are not monotone, are not graphs in the positive directions, right? If you have a matrix that has 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, right, and you take some positive matrix, then you can cross the surface a couple of times. You can cross the surface again at 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so ellipticity, if you want to study this problem in an elliptic context, for instance, you have to choose the set of convex or concave functions. Okay. Let me make a comment more, because I made this comment that I said that to define Monge-Ampere or to define the Laplacian, you have to be able to list all the super subsolutions, quadratic polynomials which are super solutions, and quadratic polynomials which are subsolutions. This is not a trivial remark, or it looks like. But I want to point to the idea of that to study the connection between sort of regularity and Liouville problems. In other words, is to many times to understand for a free boundary problem, for a fully nonlinear problem, and so on, to understand the regularity, and this I'm going to use later, you have to be able to classify what are the global profiles. And so in some sense, what I'm saying is that the second order equation f of the square of u is defined by knowing the global solutions, which are the quadratic polynomials. Okay. The final remark I would like to do is a connection. In some sense, the idea of viscosity solution is basically is already present in some sense in the Perron's method. Okay. In fact, if you look in the classical literature, how to construct a harmonic function. Right, how to construct a harmonic function in a given domain, right? There is the energy method, the Dirichlet principle, and there is the balayage, which is the following. You start, so suppose I want to, so you give me this boundary data, and I want to construct a harmonic function that takes this boundary data, right? Then you said, okay, let's start with all the superharmonic functions. So what is the Perron method? I want to construct this line, right? Then I said, to construct this line, I'm going to look at all the concave functions above the two endpoints. Okay? So I'm going to take all the concave functions above the two endpoints, and the minimum of two concave functions is a concave function again. Okay? So that means that I can take the infimum of all concave functions, okay, and this still will be concave, right? Then one possible concave function is this line. Another possible concave function is this line. So the minimum of all concave functions is going to be above these lines. All concave functions are going to be, below these lines. All concave functions are going to be above this line, so I will get an object in between, right, which is still is concave. But if it's not a line, I can take a segment and get a smaller one. Okay, so this is the Perron method. Perron method, you say I take, so if I want to do a harmonic function this way, the only thing I need is this little piece, right, which is to be able to solve the equation in a small domain, in a small nice domain, which for harmonic functions we know how to do. I need this, and I did some some uniform regularity, which in the case of concave functions is easy because they are all Lipschitz, and in the case of harmonic functions is the Harnack inequality or some a priori estimate like that. Okay. So there are two ideas underlying in the Perron method. One is sort of the viscosity solution idea. In other words, these are basically what you are doing is you are taking all the viscosity super solutions and taking the minimum. And the other is an idea which is very useful in many problems, which is the idea of looking at constraint problems. Okay, so suppose that. So suppose that you give me some boundary value, right, this domain, and I want to construct a harmonic function, right? But I don't know very well, suppose it's not exactly harmonic, has a right-hand side, whatever, I don't know very well if I can even construct a super solution, okay? So one thing you can start doing is the following, right? So suppose I give you, so let me write a sort of a Perron generalized theorem. Suppose you give me any function phi 2 above the boundary data, any function phi 1 below the boundary data. Okay. Then if phi 2 and phi 1 are not harmonic or superharmonic or whatever, I don't know if I can construct the harmonic function. For instance, it could be that phi 2 and phi 1 that phi 2 is like this, and phi 1 is like this, and so between these I cannot construct the harmonic. But I can construct some optimal thing which is as harmonic as I can. Okay, in other words, I can construct a function that is harmonic in between, right? So I can construct, the best I could do is this function, right? In some sense. I mean, I can construct many functions which are piecewise linear in between, but this is the best, right? Why is this the best? Okay, this function is the best because it is superharmonic as long as I don't touch the top, and it's subharmonic as long as I don't touch the bottom. Okay, so that you can do by Perron method. You can take the least function which is superharmonic as long as you don't touch the top, and you will end up with this function. Okay, so theorem, I can construct a U that is superharmonic U continuous, which is superharmonic when U is less than phi 2, subharmonic when U is bigger than phi 1, and therefore is harmonic when it is in between. And if you prescribe the boundary values, this function phi 1 is unique. Okay? And so in many problems, you can construct this and then see if you can get rid of the phi 1 and the phi 2. There's many problems, especially for global solutions. And this is an idea which is very fruitful. Okay, so what I would like to discuss in this next few hours is several, well, it's maybe only two, but I would like to discuss sort of some problems which are nonlinear, they are in non-divergence form, so you have to use these ideas that come from highly oscillatory media. So what is a homogenization problem? So the idea of homogenization problem is the following. Suppose you have, most classical problems come from continuum mechanics, and suppose you have a medium which is highly oscillatory. Okay, for instance, you have a composite material. I think one of the first problems that were solved, I think that this is what made the Georgie look at this problem, had to do with the rods of a nuclear reactor. And so you have a nuclear reactor which has a very complex structures of rods, and if you go to Google, you will find dozens of papers because they have rods of many scales. You know, they have rods, it's a more or less a periodic structure, but they have rods of a scale, and inside have rods of a smaller scale, and so on, and they have flow through. And so you want to compute, so the flow is very complex at the small level, right? But you want to get some sort of large scale estimate, okay? And so you ask the following question. You ask the question, suppose I have a medium, a periodic medium, right, which is, has some scale. So I have so suppose it has little little rods inside rubber or whatever, and you want to, or carbon fibers, or what, and you want to sort of, if you try to solve an equation, you have to solve the heat equation for this medium, right? Then what you have to solve is an equation, right? Di Aij dj of u, right? Where Aij is very oscillatory. I mean, it's oscillatory of this period, right? So it's a function Aij of x. So let's say that first we look from nearby, so these things for us are of order 1. Okay, then this coefficient is Aij of x, right, which is periodic of period 1. Okay. But if you start to look from far away, this is equivalent to, so let's call this solution, the solution of this problem U1 with some boundary data. If you start to look from far away, this is equivalent to making the change of coordinates di Aij of x over epsilon dj of the corresponding solution U epsilon. Okay, so this is the natural change of coordinates if you want to contract the space. Right, what was before 1 now happens when x is equal to epsilon. Okay, so even if the original coefficients Aij were very nice functions, right, now they oscillate of order epsilon. So they are highly oscillatory. Now no general theory function except bounded measurable coefficients. But in some sense, what you expect is that when epsilon goes to 0, sort of the detail disappears, right? So you expect solutions U epsilon of this problem to go to some function U0 that now will satisfy an equation which is invariant, constant coefficients, right? No dependence in x anymore, okay? These are constant. And this gave rise, this is a classical homogenization theory, started maybe with, I think, the gamma convergence theory of the Georgie and so on. Then was the compensated compactness theory of Murat and Tartar and so on, and it's very, I mean, it's a highly sophisticated theory. And if an important ingredient, right, is the following. So heuristically, the way you can understand how to find a solution. Okay, first let's do the 1D. So first let's do the 1D, right? If you do the 1D, dx of A of x over epsilon, dx of u equal to 0, let's say. So A of x over epsilon, dx of u epsilon equal to a constant, let's say 1, right? So U epsilon is the integral, let's say, from 0 to x of 1 over a of t over epsilon. So this is a very highly oscillatory function, right? But then as epsilon goes to 0, the integral becomes the integral of a constant, right? In other words, this function converges weakly to a constant, right? It's a weak, but it's a weak convergence, not of a of x. It's a weak convergence of 1 over a of x. In other words, the easy guess that the homogenization limit is going to be the weak limit of the matrix A is not true. Okay, it's a much more complex limit. Okay, in general, there are no formulas; they are just numerical simulation. Okay. Okay. The other observation, which is sort of, we will see a lot appear, is the idea of correctors. Okay, that is easy to see in the divergence form case. So the idea of correctors is the following: is to say, so you make the ansatz that the u epsilon, right, is like your limit u0 plus an oscillatory part. U0 plus oscillatory part. Right? So how do you can see this oscillatory part? You can see, for instance, a way that I like to see this oscillatory part is from the energy point of view. Okay, so in other words, a function u, solution of the epsilon problem, right, will be a minimizer of something like gradient of u epsilon, right, transpose aij of x over epsilon, gradient of u epsilon. Okay? So one can make the answer that in order to try to minimize this quantity, right, then u0 will be sort of a regular part that sort of takes into account of the global aspect of the problem, right? So a regular part u0 plus, and then see in every little square, you want to have a correction, right, where the gradient to correct for the aij, which is oscillating of order one, the gradient has to oscillate also of order one, right? In other words, to compensate for the wiggling of the aij, the gradient has to oscillate of order one. In other words, the correction has to be of the form epsilon c of x over epsilon, so that oscillates in squares of order epsilon, and the gradient oscillates of order one. Okay, so the natural scale of the correction is epsilon c of x over epsilon. Okay? And now comes this idea of global profiles, where I said, okay, let's rescale the epsilon. Okay? So let's rescale the epsilon. What is the natural rescaling? Well, u0 is going to be the smooth function, right? So u0 will start like a constant. Constants don't import, doesn't matter in this problem. So we'll start like 0, right? So how is the starting of u0? U0 will be constant, linear, and quadratic. Okay? So the natural scaling that will keep the main part of u0, that will keep the gradient part, is the linear, the homogeneity one scaling. In other words, we want to make the correction, so we want to make the scaling u epsilon of x over epsilon, epsilon. No, what I'm saying, u epsilon of epsilon x 1 over epsilon, right? In other words, now I am making a dilation of the space, okay? If I make the dilation, this dilation of the space, as epsilon goes to 0, u epsilon will preserve the linear part, right? Because this scaling preserves linear part. We agree that we can make u epsilon equal to 0 at the origin, so it's no constant, right? The quadratic part will have an epsilon square and disappears. And so the u epsilon will be a linear function. And this will be a bounded function. And we'll satisfy now a periodic equation with period 1. Right? So we can hope that we can construct such a C periodic. Because if C is a solution, the translation of C in any period will be a solution again. Okay? So there is a periodic C which is called a corrector. In fact, I prefer to look at the whole thing and call this the, so this is the corrector. Why is it called the corrector? Because it corrects the linear function to make it a solution of the oscillatory equation.
Right? You said that this was an energy considerations you're thinking about this? When you said you're writing up U as U naught plus an oscillatory part.
No, no, the answer that is a U naught plus another part is just the answer that in the limit will be a smooth solution, it's a solution
okay.
of a smooth equation.
All right, but there's no energy considerations here at all.
No, the energy consideration is in the fact that the corrector has to have this scaling.
That scaling, okay.
Okay?
Scalar, okay. Mm-hmm.
That's it, all right. Okay? I mean, this is all heuristic, then you prove it.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, and also the periodicity is the fact that if you have the translation of a solution is a solution. So if you have a bounded solution of a periodic problem, such that the translation of the solution is a solution, there is a good chance that you can construct it to make it periodic, right? Okay? So this corrects the linear function to make it a solution of the oscillatory problem. Okay? And for reasons we will see later, I prefer to look at the full profile and call this a, this is the plane-like solution of the problem. In other words, you give me a plane, and I can find a solution of the oscillatory problem, which is a bounded perturbation of the plane. Okay. And in fact, the plane-like solution of a problem sort of it is like a feeding problem. You give me the oscillatory problem. I find the corrector, and once I find the corrector, this forces what should be the limiting solution. Okay? And the reason is the following. This is the idea of global profiles, which is that a variation and integral that doesn't depend on x, in some sense, is prescribed by knowing the energy of any plane. Because the f of gradient u, right, when you are telling me I'm minimizing, and this is linear and non-linear, right? If you are minimizing f of gradient u, if you don't know what are you minimizing and you want to find out, what you have to know is the value of f on any vector v. That is, you have to find out the energy, the average energy of the functional in any plane. Okay? So the planes for a variational problem, the planes are the global profiles. And so here what you find is the corrected global profiles. In other words, you find the plane-like solutions of the oscillatory problem, and when you compute the average energy of this quantity, in other words, if you plug this into the original oscillatory equation now, you take the plane-like solution and you plug it into this integral, epsilon equal to 1 now, because we have rescale, right? Since it's periodic, it has an average energy, right? This energy, the amount of energy is the same in every cube by periodicity. And the effective energy, the energy of this quantity is the effective energy of the problem. In other words, is the equation or the variation or the minimization problem that the limit satisfies. Okay? In other words, here it is, I did it for this is a classical theory for the linear problem, right? For the linear problem, you just need three correctors. By linearity, if you can correct x1, x2, and x3, you can correct everything else. For the nonlinear problem, every plane has to have a corrector, okay? And you get a nonlinear energy functional, okay? And so this is sort of, I want to stress, this is this idea that sort of the global profiles, right, are the ones that characterize. So So in homogeneity, this is something that happens in general, just that sort of you have to sort of describe the equation by knowing sort of the global, the energy of the global profiles, or what are the global profiles, and so on.
You're talking about compact domains.
Pardon? Well, the equation, the homogenization problem is to understand what are the limits for any.
Right, but the main is on which the.
It's periodic. This is a periodic media. Yeah.
Okay, then how do I understand the energy? Energy will diverge.
No, no, the energy is the average energy of the linear thing. You take the linear function, and then the average energy. You take 20 cubes, the energy is 20 times the energy of a cube. If you take 100 cubes, I want to understand, yes, it's the energy of a cell, because here the problem is perfectly periodic. But I want to understand it in general as the average energy of the global profile. Because when you take, for instance, I'll discuss minimal surface in periodic media, right, and if you take an irrational direction, then the corrected surface, the plane-like surface, does not have a periodic energy. It is the average energy. Like if you take geodesics in a periodic media, the length, you cannot talk of the length of a period, but you can talk of the average, the effective length at long distances, okay?
But you rescale the problem. So you start with very tiny cells and then rescale them to union cell, to union.
Yes. Yes, and that gives you an average energy, and then when the cells go to zero, right, then the limit is the limiting equation, which corresponds to infinity in this scaling, is the average energy of the plane. In this case, the average energy coincides with the energy of a cell, because the problem is periodic. If the problem is not periodic, you rescale, and then you have to find the average energy at infinity in some sense, because then you rescale back. And this is the effective energy when epsilon goes to zero. Okay? Okay? Okay. So let me stop here since it is 3L. Dij of u equal to 0, right? Or suppose that you have a of x lambda plus lambda minus equal to 0, right? It's a fully nonlinear equation where the coefficient a of x is a periodic coefficient between 2 and 3, okay? So you have this periodic medium, right? So Aij is of period 1 as before, or A of x is of period 1 as before in the plane, let's say, right? And then you are looking at equations of this form. And you want to see what is the effective limit, okay? So what is the effective limit? So the effective limit, here you expect it to be some equation, aij, constant coefficients, dij of u. Right? And here you expect it to be some fully nonlinear equation, f of the square of u. Okay. And so in the same spirit in which we did sort of the plane-like solutions, right? Now you ask, okay, which quadratic polynomials are going to be solutions of this equation. If I can tell you, if you give me a quadratic polynomial, and I can tell you if it is a super or a subsolution of the equation, then I am defining for you the operator. Okay, this is the difference. In the divergence case, any plane will be a solution of the limit. And what you have to find is the effective energy of this plane. In other words, you will describe the equation by finding the effective energy of this plane. Here is the other way around. To define the operator, it's like a compatibility condition. In other words, you give me a polynomial p, right? And then I have to try to make a quadratic polynomial-like solution of the oscillatory equation. In other words, I rescale. I have the oscillatory equation in a medium, which is very thin. I rescale it to 1 as before, right? And as I rescale it to y as before, I make the answers that solutions of these equations are going to be like a polynomial plus a corrector. Okay? And so you give me a polynomial p, right? And I ask, okay, can I find a corrector? Okay, a corrector has to be a corrector. It's a corrector that scales quadratically, right? In other words, in the epsilon thing will be p plus epsilon squared c of x over epsilon, because it involves only second derivatives. You rescale, and then you ask, you have this global. This, now you have this global problem, cells of size 1, right? P plus c, right? And you ask, can I find a corrector c, a periodic corrector c, such that p plus c is a solution of the equation aij by dij of this equal to 0? Okay. So basically, what I have is this, right, is aij times a matrix plus the equation in a cell, aij, I want the epsilon problem, the one problem, aij of x, the periodic. So I want to, you give me a p, right, and I want to add the corrector to make it a polynomial-like corrector of the oscillatory equation, right, as I did before. Okay? So you give me the polynomial, and I want to find the corrector. Okay? And so I try to find the corrector, and I get a periodic C, so I get a periodic equation, right? And here, I get some term, right? And then you can show that this is a compatibility condition. In other words, if I take the polynomial P and I add plus Tx squared, right? In other words, if I, instead of looking at just the polynomial p, I look at the polynomial p, and I perturb it by a positive matrix, let's say p plus tx squared, right, plus c, plus a corrector, and I try to find a solution. I want to try to find a corrector for a solution of the equation. You realize that there is exactly one t for which you can solve. In other words, there is exactly one t for which the periodic quantity you have here is compatible with the periodicity condition, right? The periodicity condition implies sort of a cancellation on the boundary. Okay, if it were divergence, it would be like integral of u nu equal to 0. Okay? So here,
Right.
It's not self-adjoint because it's not divergent, but it's exactly. It's the standard compatibility condition. Okay, and so what is this telling you? This is giving you the list of polynomials that are solutions of the limiting equation. In other words, you give me a polynomial and I do t plus x. There is a t zero such that for t less than t zero, P is going to be a super solution of the limiting equation. For T equal to T0 is going to be a solution. For bigger one, it's going to be a subsolution. So that way, I am defining the homogenization limit. Of course, the theorem then is to prove that indeed, you know, a sequence of solutions of the oscillatory problem converges to a solution of the homogenization limit, right? In other words, the limiting profiles idea just tells you what the limiting solution equation should be. Then you have to prove the convergence theorem. Okay? But so here is again this idea. Now the idea is not that every plane as before was a global profile and they give you the effective energy. For non-divergence equations, this tells you what are the global profiles of the effective equation. And you can do it a fully nonlinear equation, and it's exactly the same. In other words, if I give you this problem, it's exactly the same. It's a nonlinear problem that you have to solve for C, but still you can see that there is, if I take a polynomial P and I add T x squared, that is, I'm making the polynomial for T negative, I'm making it very concave, right? For T positive, I'm making it very convex, and somewhere in between, there is the exact P for which I can construct a corrector, or as I like to call it, a sort of altogether, is like the polynomial-like solution of the oscillatory equation. Okay? And this is something that you, as I said, that we you can do in many circles. You can do for free boundary problems, for integral nonlinear equations. So it's an idea that is rather works well in a general context. Okay, so now I would like to start discussing. So I'll try to discuss two or three examples of how this theory works in different nonlinear problems. What I have, where is the? We lost him, okay. Okay.
I can try to experiment.
What I have now are mainly pictures. So I think, no. I think, let's try without that. Because I'm going to put some pictures and write. So more what I need is, that's it. So what I want now is to, let's see. What I want is just to, we should find a way to.
Just want the projector.
Hmm? The projector, yeah. Hi. No, don't, just put the projector, see what happens.
I have the remote back here.
Let's see, full screen, where is full screen? Bars, master. I cannot find full screen. What is it, full screen, F what?
For full screen?
Yeah. You see anything? You don't see. Oh, you don't. Turn off the lights. Yeah, a little bit. See. Shade, dark. No, I know this is.
Turn around, maybe.
The front lines. The front row. The lines. Yeah. Can we turn this line in the front? There. Okay, more or less. Okay, so the first thing I want to discuss is an old problem that Moser proposed in the late 70s that has to do with constructing a plane-like minimal surfaces in periodic media. Okay, so the problem comes from two areas. Moser proposed it because he was interested in dynamical systems, and where you study sort of geodesics in periodic media. But it also comes in problems of phase transition. Minimal surfaces comes in problems of phase transitions, and if you have a media which is periodic, then the phase transition is a surface which is minimal in some weighted periodic media. Okay, so. So for geodesics, the issue is, this was an old theorem of Morse, that says that if you have some, suppose you have some sort of periodic media. So you have some hills and you walk along the hills and you want to go from A to B. Okay? And so you ask, so you take the geodesics and you ask, is the geodesic going to stay at finite distance from the line? In other words, as A and B get further and further away, are the geodesics going to stay at finite distance from the line, or would you have to travel far away and come back? Okay? And Moser showed, Morse showed in the 30s that indeed if you have a periodic media and you take the geodesics in the plane in 2D, then geodesics remain at a constant distance from the line. So you have, so in some sense you can talk, you know, if you're looking at geodesics, you can think of an homogenization problem where what you want to find out is the effective distance. In other words, if you travel very far away along the line, if you go to two points in the lines and you make these points to be very far away, right, then does the distance averages to some distance. Or if you want to think like that, you start at a point, right? So if you start at a point and you start to follow a geodesic, right, far away, far and further away, then will it this, will, how does this converge to a distance function which is just a norm? Okay, in other words, can you get in the limit at infinity, you will get that the distance becomes a norm. It has, in each ray, becomes averages out to some constant. Okay, so he wanted to, so basically, you can think of this as an homogenization problem, and you can think of the geodesics as the line-like solution. In other words, here you don't do the difference between the geodesic and the line and call that the corrector, because the line is not periodic. The line may have an irrational direction, and therefore the geodesic will not be periodic, right? But still, if you look at the, instead of separating the corrector from the linear part, you put it all together, this will be the line-like solution of the homogenization problem, okay? And so he showed that indeed there are like the correctors in homogenization. Now, in 3D, it was known, I think, almost at the same time, there was a very nice counterexample due to Hevlund that shows that in 3D, the geodesics do not remain at finite distance from a line. Okay, and the proof, the constructions he did was the following. He constructed a family of three orthonormal sets of pipes, right? One vertical, one horizontal this way, one horizontal this way, that stay at a fixed distance from each other. And they said, okay, I'm going to charge one as long as I move inside the pipes, but as soon as I go two epsilon times the pipe, twice the radius of the pipe, I'm going to charge M. I'm going to charge a lot, okay? And then, so you take now a diagonal of the cube, a large diagonal of the cube, and you just project the geodesic. It's a very simple computation. You project the geodesic on the diagonal of the cube, and then you realize that the geodesic, that is the cheapest way to go from opposite points, you take a cube, and to go from here to here, right, if the medium is very small, as the medium becomes very small, the cheapest way to go is to only jump three times. Okay, so it's not worthwhile to jump a lot. So the geodesic becomes basically asymptotically these three sides of the cube. So not only the geodesic is not line-like, does not stay at finite distance from the diagonal. In fact, it's separates of order the diagonal, the same length of the diagonal, okay? And therefore, the sort of the effective distance is a very bad, well, it's a very bad, it's just the L1 distance, right? It's the sum of the three sides whose unit ball is not too nice because it has flat parts and angles, okay? So it has no regularity in it. So what Moser proposed at the time was that maybe he did this in connection with foliating the torus. And, you know, he thought of the geodesic thrusters, instead of being a periodic plane, he thought of geodesics going around the torus and having a general direction. And he And he suggested that maybe this was, in this case, was a problem of a codimension being bigger than one, and that one should try to foliate the torus. In other words, one should try to find bisurfaces. In other words, he said, okay, let's look at the sort of at the minimal surfaces, right, which are minimal respect to some oscillatory differential of area, right, weighted differential of area in a periodic media. So we are here in R3, and so in each cube we have a periodic weighted differential of area, right? You know, you take a cell and you can say, okay, in this part of the cell I'm going to charge 3 times what I charge in the rest of the cell. Or you can charge something that depends on the position and the normal vector to the surface. Okay, so some rather general weight as a differential of area. And then he asked the question, can you find, given a plane, can you find a plane-like minimal surface of the oscillatory problem? Okay, in some sense, if you want to think of this as an application, you can think of it as you take a rack, right, which has long fibers, and you throw water, right, and so the water, in principle, will propagate and find a shape on the rack. We are trying to minimize the area for fixed volume, okay? But the area will be the area associated to the rack. In other words, the shape of the stain will not be a perfect circle. It will depend on how the fibers are arranged and so on. And so if you want to find the effective shape of the stain, you have to know what is sort of the effective differential of area when you take the limit, okay? In other words, when you think that the fibers of the rack become smaller and smaller with respect to the shape, the size of the stain, then asymptotically will converge to some convex set because the wiggling will disappear, but this convex set is going to be given by the effective differential of area here. And so following the idea of homogenization, so the idea is this one, is that to understand, for instance, that homogenization problem, you have to construct the plane-like minimal surfaces, and then if you take the average area, weighted area of those minimal surfaces, this is the effective area of the plane. In other words, you homogenize, the homogenization limit, right, will be a convex set, but where the area is arranged to minimize area, but where the area is the effective area of the wiggling plane. In other words, you can think that any little piece of this convex set, if you magnify it, right, it is just not a plane, but it is this very wiggly thing, right, that has some area. Okay. So this is a problem we worked with the La Llave a few years ago, and so geometrical is not too hard. And it uses a little bit some of the ideas I discussed before. So let me try to present it to you. Okay, so so what I'm going to do is I want to remain sort of in a bounded situation. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a plane which has which is rational. In other words, such that the normal is rational, it's integers, and therefore they are the, I expect the plane-like surface to be periodic. But I'm going to get estimates which are independent of how rational the vector is, okay? And so I can pass to the limit and I can get the minimal surfaces for any direction of the plane, okay? So what I'm going to do, as I said before, you know, I don't know if this surface separates or not, right? I could say, let me take a big piece of plane, right? Let me take a big piece of plane and solve, minimize the wiggly area with boundary, this boundary, right? But precisely this is what I don't know. If I start to do that, I don't know if the surface is going to start to get further and further away as I enlarge the cube. That's what happened with the geodesics, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start by solving the constraint problem, and then I'm going to convince you that if the band that I take is width enough, independent of the direction of the plane, then the surface becomes free. In other words, the surface becomes a real minimal surface, okay? So I take, you give me a direction of a plane, I take a direction of a plane which is rational, so I can take about periodic surfaces, okay? And I'm going to work on the context of boundaries of sets of finite perimeter. In other words, my surfaces are going to be boundaries of sets, right? And I expect the surface to have, you know, to have finite weighted area is the same as having finite area because the weight will be bounded away from 0 and infinity, okay? So I'm going to ask my surfaces to be of finite perimeter, and then I am going to minimize among all of the periodic surfaces which are trapped, such that the boundary is trapped in this width, I'm going to minimize the weighted area. And there is a standard hypothesis for the weighted area, which is in the work of Shen and Simon and so on, that makes it elliptic. So the standard hypothesis is if the weighted area depends on the normal vector, right? So you have your surface and you take a little piece and then you take the differential of area and you are going to weight it by maybe the direction of the normal and the position, okay? And about the direction of the normal, the weight has to be, if you extend it homogeneous of degree 1, right? So you have a weight, so you are doing the integral of differential of area times some function that depends, let's say, on the normal and the point. Okay, and then for fixed x, the dependence on the normal has to be such that when you extend this homogeneous of degree 1, that is when you define for any vector f of lambda nu equal a lambda f of nu, then that has to give you a convex cone. Okay, so this is the ellipticity condition. And if you have that, then if you have a, you know, this, as I said before, avoids that wiggles have more area than flat things. Okay, and so if you take a sequence of sets of finite perimeter that converge where the weighted area converges to a minimum, this converges to a set that is a minimizer. Okay, so it's to construct a minimizer for each one of these problems is not a problem. Okay, this is okay. So the issue now is really to get rid. But this is going to be a minimizer over here, right? Over here is going to be sort of a subsolution, right? In other words, if I perturb up, I have to get more area because this is an admissible perturbation. But if I perturb down, right, I don't know. I may get more area or not, okay? So it's a one side inequality here, one side inequality on the top, okay? And so I want to show that if I can construct such a surface in such a way that the constraints disappear for a wide enough strip. And the width of the strip will depend only on the oscillation of the weight. Okay, so this is the only dependence is on the oscillation of the weight. So the first observation, and this is a very, this is, has to do with ordering, as I said. So this is a variational problem, but still has many features which are non-variational in it. And the first one is order, is the fact that many times if you want to construct a special solution, what you have to do is to find or the least supersolution or the largest subsolution. So here, in some sense, we are constructing the least supersolution. What do I mean by that? I mean, if you give me two solutions, right, and I take the minimum, they take the intersection. See, the good thing about this approach is that there is an ordering because these are boundaries of a set. Okay, so I can take the intersections of the set, the intersections of the set below, and this gives me one piece of the boundary. I can take the union, and this gives me another piece, right? So the intersection will be, so I have these two pieces. I have the union and the intersection, okay? And if I add the pieces together, I get the same, right? If I take the two original pieces, in other words, if I had two minimizers, right, and one was like this, and the other was like this, and then I take the maximum, let's say, the union, the boundary of the union, of the boundary of the intersection, right, and I add up the areas of the pieces, that the areas of the pieces is the same as the sum of the original areas, right? So I have the area of M1 plus the area of M2 is equal to the area of M1 intersection M2 plus the area of M1 union M2, right? By this I mean the sets, not the boundaries, okay? So if these two were minimizers, these two are minimizers again, okay? And therefore, I can talk about the minimal minimizer, that is the minimizer which is the intersection of all minimizers. And this is like a very Perron argument, right? Where you are taking the least supersolution to construct your solution. Okay, so what is good about the minimal minimizer? The minimal minimizer has very special recuperates very special properties that the general minimizer doesn't necessarily have. So the first thing that the minimal minimizer have is that it is almost translation invariant. Okay? This problem is not translation invariant, right? But I can translate by an integer vector. And then I get another problem in a translated strip that has the same minimizers, right? In other words, if I have this strip, and I have a minimizer here, right? And I take a point in the lattice. So here I have underlined this, I have the lattice, right? So if I take a point in the lattice, and I take any other point in the plane in the lattice, and I translate by this, right? Then this strip translates over there. This strip translates, the minimizer translates over there. And this is a minimizer of this problem. Right? So I can translate by integer vectors, and I have the configuration is a minimizer of a similar problem. Okay? Now, suppose that I translate in such a way that I make a translation in such a way that the strips superpose. Okay? So suppose that I have this strip, right, this strip has width m, right, and I have this point, and I translate. Anyway, maybe this point may go, but the strip superposes a little bit. So suppose that this is, they have this translation, and the strip superpose. Okay? So then I have the minimal minimizer here, right? Okay? And I have the translation of this minimal minimizer over here. Okay. Now again, the union, right, the boundary of the union is a surface which is admissible for the higher strip. Right? The boundary of the union is admissible for the higher strip. The boundary of the intersection is admissible for the lower strip. It's all contained in the lower strip. Okay. The original were minimizers. These are also minimizers because if I put the pieces together, right, I get the sum of the areas. Okay. So this piece and this piece are minimizers. But this piece is smaller or equal than what I said was the smaller minimizer. Unless there is no intersection. See, unless this piece all remains and this piece is all above. Okay? In other words, the minimal minimizers have the property that if I make any translation that moves the strip a little bit down, right? Then the translation of the minimal minimizer is the is below the translation of this special minimizer is below itself. Okay, and this is almost like a statement of periodicity. It's not exactly periodicity, right? But it's almost periodicity because I can make a translation which is very, very, very far away, right? And nevertheless, it moves the strip just one square, right? In other words, I have the strip, I have the basic strip, let me take the basic strip, right? And let me take the middle plane, right? And suppose I take a point in here, right? And I go very far away, here. I may not find a point in the line, but here there is some square, right, which is crossing the line, okay? So I can make the translation that goes from this point to this point, right? This moves the strip at most by a unit, right? Because always there is a square that touches the surface, no matter how far I go. So these translations move the strip just by a union, but can go very far away. All over I can translate like this, right? So with tolerance one unit, this thing is periodic. Okay? And then we can do the following argument. I say, suppose then that I can manage to find a clean cube here. For instance, a cube, right, which is outside of omega. Okay? Then if I make any of these translations, right, translation went down, then this cube is clean. Okay? Any translation that I do that moves this, that for any cube that is above, is clean. Okay, because any translation that I do that moves to another cube moves the minimizer, minimal minimizer accordingly. Okay? Therefore, if I can find just one clean cube here, then for any cube anywhere that is above, that cube does not touch omega. Okay, because of this almost periodicity property of the minimal minimizer. Okay. In other words, I cannot say exactly this cube, but as soon as I move a little bit up, that is clean. So that means that if I find just one clean cube, then I don't need the top constraint. The surface never touches the top constraint. Okay? So to find a clean cube, all you need is two elements. The first one says that a minimal surface has a density property on both sides. For a standard minimal surface, the argument is an ODE. For a standard minimal surface, you take, suppose I have a minimal surface in some decent way, right? And I have the ball of radius r, right? Then from one side, I have the isoperimetric inequality that tells me that the volume of this domain is less than the area of the boundary to the n over n minus 1. But since this is minimal, this area is smaller than this. So this is smaller or equal than constant 2 times the area of this piece of the sphere. To the n over n minus 1. And this is the derivative of the volume. Okay? So you solve this as an ODE, you solve this ODE, and you see that the volume here is always of the order R to the n. Okay? The volume of omega intersection VR, the volume of complement of omega intersection VR is like R to the n, is of order R to the n. Okay? If you have an oscillatory differential of area, the only difference is, okay, the volume, right, is less than the area of the boundary, but this part is smaller than capital lambda divided by little lambda, that is the coefficients that bound the weight by above and below, times this area. So here you have capital lambda over little lambda, no big deal. Okay? And so the ODE is the same with capital lambda over little lambda. Okay? So here the volume is like a constant R to the n, but where this constant depends on capital lambda over little lambda. And this is the only factor that will appear in the proof. So as I said, the proof depends only on the oscillation of the weight. The next observation is, in fact, not only that, we can say that inside this domain, if this is a ball of radius R, inside this domain there is a ball of radius a multiple of R, which is fully contained. Okay? And the reason is the following. Let me cover, you cover this with, let's say, cubes or balls, right? And then, if in any piece of this you find a point on the boundary, right, anytime you have a point on the boundary from the density property, you have a whole piece of omega and complement of omega. But then the isoperimetric inequality says that the superating surface has area of order r to the n minus 1. Right? If you have in the ball, you have two domains of volume of order 1, the separating surface has area of order 1. Okay, so you put all these pieces together and add them up, and they add to too much. Right? Because these are r to the n little squares. Okay, and 1 over r to the n little squares. And each one has a piece of area r to the n minus 1. Okay, so that means that there is not only this, but there is a clean ball or a clean cube. If you take the ball of radius r and you have a minimal surface on both sides, there is a clean cube. Okay? Okay, now the second part of the argument is to show that there is one clean cube somewhere. Right? Okay. If there is not one clean cube somewhere, that means that the minimal surface is crossing everything. No, above or below. I just want a clean cube, inside or outside. Okay? So if there is not a clean cube anywhere, means that the surface cuts everything. Right? And so then we can estimate by below the area of my minimal surface, right, is like a multiple of the sum of the areas of the cubes. A small multiple, little lambda, let's say, right? But this little lambda times the sum of the areas of the cubes. And this is more than capital lambda, the area of the bottom, if M is large enough. So if this strip is high enough, right, and this wiggles around all over, we get a contradiction. So when this strip is high enough, there is a clean cube. If I take the strip of width 2 times m, there is a clean cube half the way in the strip, Okay. So I found the clean cube half the way, right? The clean cube can be above or below. So I am in the picture before now with this clean cube. If the clean cube is below, that is, if this will be inside, then that will mean that any cube below is inside, right? If the cube is outside, that means that any cube above the diagonal is outside. So I say the cube cannot be below, because then this is far from the bottom. And therefore, it is not the minimal minimizer. I can translate it one cube down, and it becomes the minimal minimizer. I mean, it becomes a smaller minimizer. So the clean cube has to be out. Okay. And so the clean cube being out means that the upper half, right? I don't need it. It's completely clean. So the only remaining problem is that this will touch the bottom, right? Or will be close to the bottom. Now this was a minimizer inside the strip. But now, since it is far from the top, I can translate it one cube up and still has the same area. So it's still a minimizer inside of the cube. But now it's not touching the top, it's not touching the bottom. So it is a full minimizer. Okay? So this basically complete the pure. As I said, this is a variational problem. Nevertheless, there are these sort of two ingredients. The ingredient of the Perron ordering, that you take the least super solution and it is very special, right? And the fact that you start with a constraint problem and at the end you sort of show that the constraint disappears. You can show, okay, let me say a few things about this problem. So this defines an effective area. You can show that the effective area is convex. In other words, you can show that this is just doing by an array. Right here, the effective area is the average area in larger and larger cubes. Okay, this is the effective area. And you can, if you want to show convexity of the effective area, what you have in other words, you want to show this ellipticity condition for the effective area, you just have to do a little tent. You take a plane like this, right, and you take any two other directions. And you make this perturbation, okay? And this perturbation have these two sides, which are negligible, and these two parts, which are bigger. And so if the thing is long enough, if the picture is long enough, then you get inequality, okay? Another way that you can look at this problem is you can look all the surfaces at the same time. The way to do that is the following. It's known, right? If you are studying minimal surfaces, you can solve minimal surfaces one by one, right? Or you can, so if I have the plane here and I'm trying to find minimal surfaces, I can find them one by one, or I can find it all together by going one more dimension. If you take one more dimension, you minimize absolute value of gradient u, right? Then, in principle, depending on the geometry and so on, but in principle, what you get is that each level surface is a minimal surface. Okay, so one other way of looking at this problem, you could try to solve. You see here, for every as you move the strip, the solution moves with the strip. In other words, you have sort of a lamination. It's not a foliation, but you have a lamination by minimal surfaces, plane-like minimal surfaces of the periodic media. Now you can do it all at once. Now what you can take, you here have the periodic media, right? And then you can take two parallel planes in one more dimension, right? So like a sandwich in one more dimension, and minimize between these two parallel planes the integral of, for instance, some function f of homogeneity of order 1 of gradient u, okay? Like could be gradient u times aij times gradient u square root, okay? And if you do that, then what you expect is to have, you find all these limit minimal surfaces at 1. So at this level, it doesn't make any difference. But when I talk about random media, this is a problem that I think is very interesting. And we don't know too much what to do it, which is if the media is not periodic, but is random, but within some nice properties, can you find minimal surfaces which will not stay on a strip anymore, but that will separate of order little law of the length of the square, okay? So can you find correctors in that sense? Another thing one can do with this is, as you see, this is a very sort of a sturdy proof. I mean, basically, it doesn't use any particular detailed properties of minimal surfaces. So for instance, we have looked in phase transition, you are interested in minimal surfaces that come from, phase transitions that come from non-local operators. And so what you get is minimal surfaces that obey sort of a minimization, an integral minimization rule. And this you can reproduce there pretty well. And I may say something next Monday, or Roque Joffrey is going to talk about that. OK, let me stop here, and I'll keep going next time. I don't know if there are questions. Questions?
Okay,
we can always ask Louis in private. Okay, thank you.